All right. All right. So this is for a class called, let's see if I can get it right, Ethical Analysis and Advocacy with Dr. Jennifer Leith, Reverend Dr. Jennifer Leith. And we are reading a book by George G.M. James called Stolen Legacy, which is about how a lot of the Greek philosophers were very well aware of, were educated originally by Egyptians in along the Nile. And so, I wanted to talk to you, Josh Nagle, my brother, my best friend, about SeeGeorgeGo and how SeeGeorgeGo is trying to kind of invigorate education in a different way than kids might traditionally see from their education in schools. So if you can start and just say a little bit about what SeeGeorgeGo is, because I feel like you'd define it and say it a little bit better than I would.
You know, I've spent a lot of time with it, so.
just a little.
Well, SeeGeorgeGo is an after-school program that I started where we take a group of kids and give them $5,000 and a goal of creating something that's good for their community on campus or the community as a whole. And so it's a lot of fun. During the project, we're using it as kind of an experiential learning process that they have to make all of the decisions. So initially with the first project, which we just launched in January, they had the option of choosing to build a community garden, a bike and skate repair center, or a recording studio. And like the first question that somebody asked was, you gave us those three options, like, but what if we came up with something else and we didn't want to make any of them? And I just looked at them and I was like, well, that would be up to you. You know, you'd have to figure out how to do that, mm-hmm. You know? And so it's truly kind of giving them this opportunity to like play at life and experience. And that for me is kind of that breeding of education. You know, they really get to interact with their world and try to figure out how it operates in real time, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And even looking at some of those barriers that can discourage us from being that playful with our money, really, in our education and our time. Yeah. I mean, you're kind of laying out a foundation where kids can try something and maybe not succeed.
Yeah. You know, and that's something that has been really cool that I think they underestimated was, you know, especially at that age, $5,000 sounds like a lot of money, mm-hmm. but to me, that's a pretty low risk and low financial investment for somebody to really start something. Like it's enough money to make something move and make something happen. But they found out pretty quick that when they chose to build a recording studio that like, oh man, that money doesn't stretch quite as far as they thought, you know, and so they really have been trying to manage that and understand how to utilize finances, which is something that we all, you know, could desperately use. And I figured that if they do fail to produce something, they probably won't make that mistake twice. I would rather make
it. At least they'll make it a different way.
Yeah, exactly. I would rather them have that opportunity to fail in a place where it feels more playful and more safe so that they can take that knowledge and expand it further. You know, I really would love to break down some of those barriers to education and you know, financial wealth and socioeconomic means are a huge part of that. You know, I was really fascinated when we were talking about Stolen Legacy about where these Greek philosophers are in location and that they like pilgrimaged over to Egypt in order to obtain what they saw as the most valuable thing, which was this knowledge that they just couldn't get anywhere else. And it was like, wow, they had a massive barrier to gaining an education and theirs was distance, right? Distance in materials. They didn't have all the books weren't copied everywhere. They couldn't just drop ship it from Amazon in 2 days, right?
No, they had to steal it from the library.
Educational theft, intellectual theft. What an amazing What an amazing idea that they saw it so valuable that it was like worth like a bank heist worth of just books, you know.
And of course, just, you know, for the record, neither of us are condoning theft of educational materials. However, I mean, it's interesting, you know, the classic line, like, life will find a way. Thank you, Dr. Malcolm. You know, some of this information or some libraries that had been destroyed continued because people stole that information. And there were other people, since we're on the topic of this book, there were other people who did go and made great sacrifices to be able to learn from the Egyptians in a more classic sense of education, where like they really had strict criteria of being taught. And so it's like you were saying earlier about Buddhist students, like you have to be ready to receive that information. And a lot of this Egyptian education, from as far as I gather from the book, was very secret and very private. And, you know, to me that sounds similar but very different than our private educational system here. But it sounds like from SeeGeorgeGo, because your students didn't fail in trying to create their sound studio, but you're kind of creating this bridge or link between private and public information. And it's not that creating a sound studio is private information or secret on how to do it, but you help create pathways where students could access and develop that information for themselves. But maybe you can talk about the success of that project.
Yeah, you know, and I think you're absolutely right. You know, pun intended, I guess, but my goal was to literally just set the stage for learning. You know, they're in an academic setting where there's definitely a time for just, you know, putting your head down and studying really, really hard, because it takes that amount of practice in order to master anything. It doesn't matter whether it's learning or playing guitar or riding a bike or running. All of those things require some diligence and mastery, but it's hard to see that link sometimes when you don't know what the final product looks like. Uh-huh. And so if I can give them that stage where they can see like, hey, all of your hard work, this is actually what you're going to do with it in the future. Like, I think that was the biggest success, you know, was just giving them that opportunity to express that creativity and work on their own terms and really figure out, wow, this stuff's really hard. Yeah. It takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of planning and a lot of effort. One student that was in he was at the recording studio for 2 days, maybe like 4 to 6 hours, but he's not even in the class. But he's this young MC named Cam, and he's a really good rapper. He was even like interviewed for the newspaper, and his quote after spending, you know, 4 to 6 hours with the rest of the SeeGeorgeGo crew was, I guess setting up a recording studio is like setting up a family. You have to work really hard at it or your family falls apart. And I was like, that, like, if you can take that energy into any work that you do, you'll find success. You're yeah. really ready to learn, you know, you're ready to be a part of that secret society. You figured it out, you know, that, you know, and that goes beyond somebody's IQ level, that goes beyond their gender, their race, their religious aspirations. Like it, that, if people have that mentality, they can really, you know, do whatever they want and help to break down some of those barriers that exist, you know? Mm-hmm. For me, that's the kind of the advocacy portion, right? You know, there's plenty of talk about privilege, and I'm certainly in the most privileged category, right? As a upper middle class to upper middle class white male in America with a lot of opportunities. I don't think I squandered those opportunities. Yeah. I hope not yet. I still have some time, I guess. But for me, the goal with that is like, hey, if you have this, you know, raise the rivers. It brings up all boats, you know? And so if I can help give somebody else that same opportunity that maybe they didn't have inherently, then that's the best way I can use my time and my energy and my value, you know, because that pilgrimage for education has literally just changed over time. You know, instead of having to go great distances to study under a teacher or a philosopher, mm-hmm. we're surrounded by information, but the barriers have become things that we can't inherently just walk through or past. You know, we have to confront these justice side of things and make sure that we're taking people on their merit and value to the system, not some arbitrary things that they really have no control over. You know, uh-huh. you can break those barriers of we don't have enough money, or we don't have enough food, or we don't have the right pigment, or we don't have the right chromosomes. Those things are so detrimental to our ability to become the best society that we can become, because we're just not expressing everybody's thoughts and ideas.
That's beautiful.
Well, you know, I
think one of the things that intrigues me about SeeGeorgeGo, and this is, you know, from someone who's at least gotten to visit and get what?
Hold on, sorry, we're getting some slowdown on the audio and video.
I've gotten to visit or get to know a lot of different organizations and nonprofits. I can't tell if it's frozen or not.
Still okay. With me?
So I sound like I'm auto-tuned?
Kind of. It's,
yeah.
Didn't know that I was interviewing T-Pain today. I like him. He's good. yeah.
One of the things that I find interesting about SeeGeorgeGo is that you're not only helping students have access to financial resources to play around with, which is huge, but also mentorship and guidance. So it's like, not only do they get to, you know, you're not like throwing some money at some students and go, yeah, okay, try to build a studio, see how it goes. It's like, no, we're not going to, you know, we're creating a system of independence rather than a system of dependence, mm-hmm. because we're saying, yeah, you want to build this? Well, we happen to have people who have seen that from start to finish, maybe several times. So why don't you work along these people who already can see every single aspect of this, and then get to trial and error on your own to see how it works for you all? You know, like, am I getting that correct?
No, or I'm over here goosebumping because I was like, oh, she gets it. Like, that's cool. You know, that's the hardest thing about a startup is trying to convey the message so that people get it, right? I take a lot of the stuff that I did and kind of mixed in my experience coaching soccer and lacrosse and trying to blend those things into an educational setting where, yes, we're building something, but what's the purpose behind building that, you know? And so we spend a lot of time working on personal growth and advocacy through our curriculum about how do jobs actually work and how do you build that thing from start to finish, mm-hmm. so that when they go on from high school to either college or career or whatever they want to do, they have a well-rounded knowledge of what's that next level look like? Like, what are they actually trying to prepare for? And then the last part is, you know, how do you bring others along with you? How do you interact with your community and be a good steward for the community as a whole? And so each month they've been looking for different nonprofits to give 10% of our revenue.
Yeah.
And so they've chosen so far to help buy supplies for a teacher's classroom who is working with students with physical and mental disabilities. And they found themselves a little short on some resources and some items that they could use. And so the students are stepping up and like ordering some supplies for that teacher. They threw a concert last or 2 weeks ago, I guess, with our cool friends, Sammy Brew and Jake Martinez. They threw a benefit concert for this group called the Dubuque Dream Center, which is like an after-school offering for disadvantaged students, particularly minorities, that gives them the opportunity to do things like play travel sports and form those teamwork things, or they have like a dance school and like music department that the kids only get to participate in when they meet their academic goals as well. So, you know, it's like, hey, it's neat that, you know, I feel like we're doing some cool stuff at See George Go, but like there's tons of other people doing really cool things, and we should try to help them and be a positive part of the community, whatever community you live in.
Mm-hmm. You know? And that's one thing that I love, one about See George Go and that project, and I'm so glad that I actually got to like see that show on my spring break. But I love that, like in Dubuque and in Denver, there's this kind of mentality where it's like, yeah, eventually at some point, everyone needs a little bit of a hand up, you know, of being just like, yeah, I am short on my supplies this month and I want to be the best teacher I can, you know. And so it's like there's always this kind of trade of resources and support and love that people like really that helps build that interconnected community. And it sounds like you're helping students access and see that that is why Dubuque and Denver work so well. It's because,
yeah,
you know, you're not only in your own band, but you're friends and you're supporting other artists and musicians around you, you know. Well, and the other thing, that I loved about getting to see that project come to fruition with that event was that it really showcases how the programs that you guys put on celebrate all intelligences, you know. Like there was the young woman who created the sign that was on the stage, and it's like you could tell that she put so much time and attention and love into that sign. And yeah, maybe that was her main role for that entire production, I don't know. But it's like everyone had their part to play, and they all did it beautifully, no matter how intensive or how much time they were able to put in. Like it looked like it was put together by a group, but also it was a group of individuals who each worked as hard as they could on what they could do.
Yeah, and that was, you know, it was fun to see everybody's talents come together. Yeah. You know? And Sam and Jake talked a lot about that to the students. And, you know, it was maybe more meaningful in a sense because the students got to see a community like really come together. You know, like they tried to raise money for the Dubuque Dream Center, but that was from donations by people in the crowd. And yeah, somebody put together this sign, and there was another girl, Elena, running around and taking photos.
Yeah,
everywhere. There were some people who were literally just going back and working in the control room, and they weren't actually like producing the sound for the music that we made, but they were fine tuning it to make it happen. And then there was people that were just trying to like build the actual recording studio, and some people were just hanging out for comic relief. And, you know, I mean, it was like this true community aspect, and they got to see how passionate Sam and Jake were because they came out here all the way from Ogden, Utah, just to work with this community. Mm-hmm. Because we met a while ago and we're like, man, this has some really cool opportunities to do education in a different way, you know. Yeah. And so, you know, we all walked away. I was really stoked on the project. I was like, oh my gosh, it works. And the students made a bunch of new friends, and they were in a room with a bunch of people that they never thought they would be, including a couple professional recording artists, and you know,
who are about the same age, like
yeah. I mean, Sam just had his 18th birthday on Friday.
Happy birthday.
And so they were, yeah, I mean, it was really like peer driven learning. I probably did the least in the room. I can definitely
because your job came beforehand.
Yeah, so I was just
planning that sets it up for success.
Yeah, I was just walking around with a grin. You know, that was pretty much the role for the entire time, which was really, really neat to see the things that they produce. Like, that's theirs, you know, for the rest of time. And that was the, I think, the gravitas towards their success was like, this is ours. He's not telling us what to do, you mm-hmm. know? So yeah.
That was very palpable in the event space. You could tell that they were just very, very proud in a positive way, not like boisterous or, you know, like smug. It was like, no, these guys are proud of good work.
Yeah.
And they should.
And they got to have a new experience. You know, that same young rapper, like we saw a young rapper fall in love with a recording studio. Same thing with, we had a 12-year-old kid stopped in and laid down some background vocals for us. You know, and I got to see all these people interact in such a different manner, you know, with adults like my friends that came in and played some music. And so we had like multi-generations kind of all in this same room learning from one another. And that, you know, created such a positive environment that had, you know, really nothing to do with anything else. It just organically came about, because that's what happens when you get diverse, talented people in the same room.
Yeah. I was having this like, where are we now moment at the event, because it was like all of our friends who, you know, are best friends in high school, who had been working with these high school students who were sitting around like best friends at those tables and stuff. And it was just like, it seemed like everyone in the audience who I talked to, it was like, oh wait, so how are you involved with this process?
Yeah.
Like, even if it was just a 10-minute little input, like everyone there seemed to have some kind of buy-in to the success of this event.
Well, and you know, I think so, a lot of that definitely speaks on like the question for your class, that, you know, how we're connected and the justice and advocacy work that we do on a micro and a macroscopic mm-hmm. layer. The way that SeeGeorgeGo is built and funded is kind of like a Kickstarter campaign. You know, we have community members who have signed up and they give $5 a month to help make this thing happen. Right. And so it was like, from a macro scale, it was, you know, people like you and my friends who are just like, I think this is a good idea. So they just kind of put their money where their mouth is. And so they made that concert happen, not just the students, not just this company that was built. Like I've always said, like, I don't really care about building a company. I want to build a community. And that got to happen right there, you know, and how that can change the events on a micro scale. Like, it affected this small group of students and this small group of our community.
Uh-huh.
But hopefully those students can take the things that they learn in the future and start applying them to those values to what they learned in SeeGeorgeGo and in their life. And so maybe they'll take that and use it to impact the next generation, and they can take those and move it on to a larger and larger, you know, macro scale of just taking macro and shrinking it down to micro into the classroom and giving them macro experience again. Yeah. You know,
confusion, you know?
Yeah. And it's like, you know, I just really hope that what comes of this, you know, I fully believe that it can move the needle or change the world in a different way, you know, is by changing the approach that we have to not just education, but the thought of like, what is the end product? You know, like, what should you do? You know, we're at such a cool point in history where it's not like, can we? It's should we and how do we?
Yeah.
You know, which is we've never been there in history where we have the ability to pull off what we have right now. And it definitely, you know, kind of how history cycles back, it definitely becomes that question of like, well, now we know how to make the pilgrimage. What things are of value and how do we get there together?
And how do we get there ethically, you know?
Absolutely.
Like, we get living in a time and a place of flourishing. We get to think about not only how do we get to that pilgrimage space, but how do we get there in the way that benefits everyone and thing that we meet along the way, rather than detracting or just taking from.
Yeah. Or
go ahead.
Oh, no, sorry.
I mean, like, you've always been a very communally minded person. Like, you're always thinking not just about what benefits you, but what benefits you is what brings everyone together and makes everyone in the room happy and smiling and feeling good about why they're in the room. Like, that's Thanks. Just always how it's been, you know, since from student government in high school to now with being your chiropractic business and with SeeGeorgeGo. And so, like, can you, since we only have about 10 minutes left, can you talk about, like, a little bit of your process and how you developed the model for education for SeeGeorgeGo? Because I know you worked with a lot with educators on what is a good educational model that is organic but also sustainable. Can it be repeated? Is it worth repeating this same model of let's give some kids some money and see what happens. Some money and some options. And
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry if this last 10 to 15 minutes becomes just like Josh overdrive mode, but that's such a massive thing. You know, in reading the questions that you sent over to me, that's probably the thing that I've struggled the most with, both from just like the storytelling side of, you know, like SeeGeorgeGo is always learning, like all of our documents are available on our website and you can look at them and you can comment on them. And I, you know, we need as much help and thought as we can get because hopefully it's always growing. So all of our documents say like, this is our current way of doing it. Like we need to remain flexible as we learn and make those changes appropriately. You helped me with the application process literally last night and by suggesting like better verbiage and being like, okay, these are some cool questions. Maybe here's some things that I would change. It's like, that is, you know, always kind of bringing that community back because I don't have all the best ideas. I have the ideas that I have, but the more I can get an outside influence and gain a better understanding of how I can do that job better, is totally invaluable, you know.
And at ILIF we call this reflexivity, and it sounds like you're not only practicing like that personal reflexivity of like how am I doing it, how am I receiving this information, but also that communal reflexivity of like,
absolutely,
does this work socially? Okay, this is how the community is adjusting this process.
Yeah.
And you work a lot with one of your mentors, Mrs. Mahan. Right?
Monahan.
Who we both had for anatomy physiology in high school.
And she is one of my favorite teachers of all time, you know, and it is because she tries so hard to empower other people, you know, and make them an active part of their own learning. And, you know, I think when it becomes reproducible is what Monahan and I are working on, you know, in the first couple courses that we're running, she's actually watching me and evaluating, and then we'll flip-flop roles and I'll watch her and evaluate her. And in the meantime, we're trying to build how do you teach teachers how to do this, mm-hmm. right? Is that a separate seminar that we just, you know, go through, or teachers that are interested, do we just invite them into the classroom and they just have to sit there and be a part of it to see what it is so that they can learn like, oh, this is what it means, right? Like my teaching style or my coaching style and Monahan's are totally different. And
right.
she's like, I don't know how I'm going to do this like without you, like you have this certain thing. And I was like, no, I don't, Monahan. We all have this certain thing. It's just that your thing is different than mine. And so you're going to interact and engage different students than I can. You're going to interact and engage with them in a different way.
Mm-hmm.
You just need a framework of like, hey, here are some flexible points that are of value when it comes to learning or the learning process. Now go make it yours. Tell that story the way that you would tell it. Don't try to tell it the way that I would tell it. That doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we're not trying.
Finding voice and style.
Yeah, I'm not trying to make a whole bunch of Josh Nagles. One is plenty enough. You know, but we can get a lot further by having these different ideas and different styles that can connect and build completely different projects. You know, a recording studio is cool, but that's just the vehicle for the bigger picture. Like, I would love to see different projects sprout up all over the US or all over the world at some point, where, you know, people are just looking, and high school students look at problems. You know, our mission statement is design a fix. You know, look around you and see what things could use help, or things that you don't like, and then don't sit back and criticize or complain them. Try to come up with a valuable solution. You know, and so hopefully in the future, students will just be submitting things that they would like to build, and we can kind of be like, all right, this meets the criteria. Check. Let's try to make that happen.
Yeah.
For where it becomes even more student driven, right? From the idea and concept phase, rather than what some boring old dude wants to do, you know?
Student and teacher driven, because you guys really do a good job of trying to support teachers where they are, you know, and for the things that they see that their classroom or students are looking for. You know, and it'd be interesting. I love how, like, the kind of model that SeeGeorgeGo uses or employs is, like, you know, not only are the students learning in this guidance-driven way, in this reflexive way, but so are you and the other developers of the organization. And it's like, well, you know, teachers are, and students, depending on their age, are at different levels of how they learn and where they learn and understanding their own voice and style. And so it's like, how do you give everyone that flexibility to, you know, some students are out there and what they're going to do is need to mimic Josh for a second just to try out until they figure out what their own voice is. Mm-hmm. Just like we were talking about Miles Davis, sometimes you just kind of like play by ear and like repeat what you're hearing so that you can learn how to play and develop your own song, you know? And like, I think that like SeeGeorgeGo really works towards developing that executive function, like that ability for students to see and analyze and make decisions and changes in their own environment. Yeah. Like, I think that's so empowering.
And you're right. I mean, that's the goal with teachers, right? Like, they need that just as much as the students, and we all kind of need that just as much as the next person. And, you know, in interviewing and talking to a lot of the teachers that I admire and that I've had over time, I was just asking them those things like, hey, what about your job do you like? What inspired you to become a teacher? What barriers are you having to that? And it was like, huh, just like the students, the teachers need a place to play. Right.
Yeah.
They need something different because they got, for the most part, you know, I don't want to speak broadly for every teacher in the world or anything, but most of them kind of had this unifying factor of like, I wanted to influence people. I wanted to help, you know, and be a part of that. And so I'd start asking them and seeing that like teachers are spending a lot of their own money on the side to support their classrooms, and they're getting second jobs to help make ends meet at times. And it was like, well, I mean, I'm sure that a teacher can do a lot of other jobs, but wouldn't it be more fun if they got to be in their own vocation?
Yeah.
They were improving their school and community and making like real bonds with students where they're not grading them, because that kind of changes the power dynamic between teacher and student. You know, they could they become more of a coach, a mentor, a friend, where a student feels like, you know, I've got one more, you know, positive person or one more touch point where somebody's there that I can trust. Because, you know, kind of going back to that micro advocacy or micro justice, is just students deal with a lot, you know, from, you know, lack of, you know, food, funds, clothing, depression, trying relationships, trying to figure out how this whole thing works.
Mm-hmm.
If something comes up, I really want them to have this place where they feel like they can go to an adult that they trust, that's maybe been there and done that, and be like, hey, here's what I'm dealing with. Mm-hmm. I need your help, right? You know, like reaching out for that help, it's scary. It doesn't matter what you need help with. It's scary to go up and have to talk to somebody about that. And the more that you have a connection with that person, the easier that discussion becomes.
Yeah.
You know, walking into it, you're not being judged. You're just there and you have a friend to listen to. And then on top of it, we get to pay the teacher $50 an hour. So they're actually making like, they're actually being paid for exactly what they know how to do best, you know?
And even psychologically, just like that, you know, feeling like your position is valued and you're valued as an educator beyond just your classroom hours and stuff, which are in intensive hours, you know, it's like, no, listen, as an educator, we want to show that it's a valued position. This is an honorable position and it's a vocation, you know, it's hard to do without seeing it as a vocation. But since we only have a few minutes left, so one of the reasons I wanted to interview you about SeeGeorgeGo is because in Stolen Legacies, it talks about kind of like 10 virtues of the Egyptian education, which were eventually kind of, like boiled into four cardinal kind of values for Plato. And so I'm looking at your website on the application page and you have like the things that money can't buy, like manners, morals, respect, character, common sense, happiness, patience, trust, integrity, love, and authenticity. So since we only have a few minutes, if you can maybe pull out like one or two of those like values and those things that we can't buy, but you're trying to encourage and talk about why those things are so important to your mission.
Yeah. Well, the one that I really hope to challenge is like, can you actually buy happiness? Like, I think you might be able to, and there's a couple studies out there that might support this, that like, if you're using your money to support other people or to, you know, gain an experience, that really like brings a feeling of happiness and joy to your life, you know? And so that's a big one. I'm sorry. I'm going to pull out my notebook here where I have those things written down just so that I can see, remember all of them, I guess. Yeah. You know, I think those 10 things that money can't buy, they really help to make somebody a well-rounded person, I guess. I don't know. It feels like a bad description, but but they're these unifying factors. Like if you want to work with other people and if you want to have a positive impact, like these things really help you reach somebody else and form an instant connection and a bond while being yourself. You know, we have all these great personalities and we just took a personality test on 16personalities.com. It's a great site. It's based on the Myers-Briggs test. Yeah. But, you know, the students found that their personalities were at times the same and varied at the same time. Like even people who had the same personality type expressed those personalities differently. Mm-hmm. And how do you work together with those people? And I think when you practice, you know, manners, morals, respect, character, common sense, happiness, patience, trust, integrity, love, authenticity, like those set the stage for somebody to really easily form a bond with somebody else, regardless of their personality type or their station in life. Right. And to me, that's the magic that happened in SeeGeorgeGo was actually all the people coming together. The recording studio was simply the product of that. And, you know, we lean into a lot of like our core values, which, you know, plenty of companies have this set of rules that kind of set the foundation for everything else. And, you know, our core values actually inspire the things that money can't buy, which are imagine, inspire, encourage, explore, be authentic, be weird, be creative, be Harriet Tubman, which means, you know, when she got hers, she went back and helped others, you know, and to encourage that behavior.
Great.
Change the world and never period give up period, which is kind of stands for like, if you take this one sentence and break it down into just pieces, it sounds mostly negative. Like you can never do that, or just give up as a sentence. And it's like, but when you put them together, it becomes never give up. And it's so much more valuable than just the sum of its parts, you know? And so I hope that with those, that's, you know, really helps propel the students to be like, you know what, if I combine all of these thoughts and apply them to myself, then it's pretty much impossible not to see success.
True.
Because the definition of success changes from person to person and from era to era, you know? And so it's really cool to see them try to figure out, like, not success by a social standard, like, what does success look like to me? And now how do I achieve those things?
Right on. And I think that what you've said really is indicative of who you are and your thought process, because even on the website, like, there are so many moments in the website where it's like, yeah, you know, in doing these positive things, we're trying to, well, let me put this pejoratively, like, correct some negative features of our own personality, like greed or selfishness, or, you know, not that all selfishness is bad, but, you know, like, rather than flaming it up like, oh, you should change yourself so you can be happy. It's like, no, here's how you foster the things that are already beautiful about who you are in a way that can encourage your personal success in your successful community, right? Like, it's not, oh, your community is failing and dying. No, it's, what are the good, wonderful things about your community? Let's uplift those.
Absolutely. Yeah. And that's
like, for you, as far as like having gotten, worked through getting to be Dr. Nagle, you know, like, even that, like, that took so much arduous patience and trust that there was an end to that. Okay, eventually I will take this test and this, I will not have to look at this piece of paper anymore. You know, like,
yeah.
I mean, you know, we're siblings, so I know how difficult school was and is. And I, from my school, I know how difficult it is. And so it's like, you are so incredibly, not just positive makes it sound like you don't recognize that there are negative things around, but you're very realistic in what success can be and is for each person, rather than just, you know, that social standard, as you mentioned.
Yeah. Well, I don't even know. That's so flattering. but yeah, I definitely think you're right. And I've, you know, fortunately been siblings with you for, like, I think all of our life. But when we were chatting last night, that was something that we talked about, that I was like, well, I've gleaned a lot of those things from all of the people that surround me, and especially you. You know, I know maybe it's one of those things that people say a lot where they're like, well, you know, they're my sibling and my best friend, but, like, I very much mean it. It's been crazy. Like, I always think back, and again, this might get a little long winded, I guess, but with how did you start this thing, and how do you tell this story for SeeGeorgeGo? It's like, you know, I don't really know where it begins, or where I begin, or where it ends. You know, they've all kind of blurred together. Like, for me, this is truly a representation of just me so far, you know. And you've been, I can't thank you enough, you've been such a big, just a huge part of that. I'm tearing up a little bit. I've just been, you've been so present, you know. And I always think that, like, one of the origin parts for me, and there's many, it's, I'm like the Joker, right? There, I don't know what is the true story, but it all happened. is thinking back to when I learned about Leonardo da Vinci and how fascinated I was, even as a child at like 9-10 years old, in the idea that he's a Renaissance man, right? Mm-hmm. Like, he was on this continual pursuit for knowledge, and he was kind of had his fingers in all the pies, kind of thing, you know, and was constantly learning and just playing around with his environment. And then I start to think about, like, well, where did that learning begin for me? And I can just think of us sitting at dad's old computer and, like, writing scary stories together. And it was like, wow, I never thought about it at the time, but we were learning together. We were learning how to craft an experience with mm-hmm. one another, you know, and then that started to roll into, well, I did this really, you know, difficult thing and went through this schooling just like you are. And it takes a ton of time and effort. And it taught me really what hard work really looks like, you know, and then I ended up on a board for a nonprofit that sets up running events in our town and gives money back to the community that way. And I was like, well, that's cool, but maybe that's not quite my mission. Like, that's not my passion project. You know, that message for me wasn't big enough or encompassing enough for what I wanted to do, but it encouraged me and taught me how I could work in that space and how could I bring that to a company that I started. And then, you know, I stumbled across the company Patagonia, and they have set the standard and the bar for what it can mean to be a private company that operates ethically. And it's like, well, you know, I've always been saying to people, like, doing good can be good business, you know? And so we're a for-profit entity. We're built as a privately held company, not because I think privately held companies are better and or worse than another thing, but it's a bit to challenge that status quo of like, where is these, you know, we're seeing some of those things like greed inside of our corporations. Like, why should somebody make, you know, $8 an hour so that somebody else can make $800,000 an hour? Like, that doesn't have to be that way. That material gain doesn't necessarily have to be the ultimate goal. And from a nonprofit standpoint, you know, because I get a lot of questions about why didn't you set it up in this way? I was like, you know what? I want to challenge other private companies to like maybe do a little bit better, because we don't exist without our community or our clients or customers or patients. And from a nonprofit standpoint, I've tried to make all of the pieces of SeeGeorgeGo really work towards this advocacy, and that every dollar that people give us is transparent and is well spent on making a difference in some way. And so mm-hmm. challenging both the private companies and the nonprofits to make sure that they're doing the same, so that they don't inflate wages, and so that they take the time to try to bring everybody along and realize that, like, hey, you can still make a great profit. Nobody's mad at you for that.
Right.
But how you get there is just as important, especially if you want to be a long-standing, you know, a 100-year company, or, you know, mm-hmm. applying that 7-generation mentality of like, how is this going to affect people way down the road?
That's the ethical analysis part, right? You do a lot of work. Like, you've been researching and learning about different business practices for a very long time, but it shows, and it's really encouraging to hear, like, a for-profit for-profit organization. That's kind of how it feels in my head.
Yeah.
Like, really put that pressure on and say, you know what, you can say that your bottom lines are the most important thing, but we're going to show you that even that doesn't, you're still going to be held accountable.
Yeah.
For action.
Well, and there's a lot of talk in business as far as like, who is the company beholden to, right? Is it beholden to its customers? Is it beholden to its shareholders? Like, who does it have this responsibility towards? And for me, it's like, you have a responsibility towards the world, like, first and foremost. Like, it's not about making profits for somebody else or, you know, lining people's pockets in some way. Like, you have this responsibility to everybody to try to make sure that we can all get there together. We can definitely all flourish, especially in the society that we have now. Unfortunately, some of the practices that we have right now aren't always conducive to that. But like I said, design a fix. You can't sit back and criticize and complain if you're not going to try to do anything about it. And so this is my attempt at doing something about it. You know, that next generation whether we want them to or not, they're going to be our next leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we can start them out on a platform that was maybe different or more thoughtful or working towards that, some of those improvements, then cool, we'll get a little bit closer with this generation, and hopefully they'll help the next generation get even closer. It's really a never ending thing.
You know? We really hope. Well, cool. I know we're kind of at time, and you need to go work at your other capacity as Dr. Josh Nagle. And so thank you so much for being willing to do this and sitting down and like getting to talk about it. It's been really fun.
Yeah, it was more than willing. Thank you for having me. This is super cool. This is like education blending together at its finest, right?
Right. And I get to introduce all my friends to all my, like, my best friend. This is
Yeah. And like we said last night, it's cool how to see both of our career paths just kind of like blending through. And of course, they blend through in an educational capacity, which is just.
Right.
I love you. You're so
it's great. So great when I go through like your work and I'm like, oh, this is so my like brother, like just because just for anyone that's listening, like, you know, Josh and I had been considered like twins basically growing up because not only do we look so similar, but we're just like, you know, melded together personality wise. And so it's like at school, we always talk about like, who's your family? Who are you? I'm like, well, just here's Josh. It's basically the same thing, but different.
This is my left arm. Her name's Emily. But yeah, this is such a great experience. Thank you so much. I love you.
I love you too. All right. Have a beautiful day at work. I'll talk to you soon.
Same. All right.
Yeah.